Okay, that's it. Somebody open the door for them. All right, we ready to go live, y'all. Welcome to the Darrell Harrison Crime Victim Foundation show. I am Darrell Harrison I.
I'm Rod Willis.
And I have two extra co-hosts on today, and we have
Valencia Harris, mother of Unique Harris, missing from Washington, D.C. since 10-10-10.
And
David Wheeler, Ward 8 advocate, elected official.
Yeah, so I brought on some extra support out here today, you know, give them my brother and sister a chance. We also have my special guest. Go ahead and talk it out, me. Boy, you ain't got the mic? Yeah, well, you know how they say, you know, when you can't run it back. What's on the show, on the show.
Right.
So like I said, we got a great show today, y'all. We got a great show. We're going to deal with domestic violence. We have a great speaker here today named Peaches. She go by the name of Peaches. She want to share her story about domestic violence, which is a wide topic now. You know, domestic violence back then was like, you know, a hand smack here or something, a bruise on your body. But now in the day, they have taken on another change of killing, burning someone. And I understand love is a powerful thing. It's amazing. You know, love is so great that it can make you feel good. And at the same time, it can hurt you. And we're going to talk about that today. Like I said, I got my sister here that assists me with domestic violence. And go ahead, sir.
Thank you, Darrell. This is McKeon Brown Anderson. I'm the founder and president of the Lakeisha Brown Foundation.
Amen. Amen. So we got a great show. Also, we got a female rapper here today. T-Spaz is here today. And we're going to have her to come out and sing her song and everything. We just gonna have a great show out there today. As everybody know, my sponsor is Soul Wings. Soul Wings Authentic Restaurant Soul Food, located at 13th and F Street Northwest, inside of the Press Building, in the food court. Go out and check them out. Great food down there. Also, my second star is Star Point. We got Star Import today. Well, Star Import out here on 4711. All place where you buy here, pay here. You got three different finances. Also, Foxway Radio has PSA announcement.
PSA announcements. Foxwave now features a streaming radio media player on its website front page where local artists can get their music played 24/7. For more information on getting your music in rotation or to perform live at the studio, contact Reg Gaskins on 240-832-4455. Android users,
thank you for
the VoxWave app is available in the Google Play Store. Download the app today on your Android devices to listen in and view programs. Business owners looking for a place to advertise your business and promote your products or services, Foxwave is the right place. We have our 10,000 views. We have over 10,000 views a day and 70,000 listeners a month. For more information, contact Reg Gaskins at 240-832-4455. In support of the community, Foxwave will be collecting toiletries such as toothpaste, soap, lotion, antibacterial wipes, socks, shampoo, combs, etc. Please drop off your donation at the station which is located at 4711 Off Place, Suitland, Maryland.
Thanks, Valencia, for reading that. As y'all know, the Darrell Harrison Crime Victim Foundation show come about me losing my son, Darrell Harrison II, on May the 5th of 2016. My son was shot through the head by a person that he didn't know. And he was in the store just trying to purchase some wings. And I promised my son, from that day on, you know, this killing would never go in vain. So it brings about the foundation that I built and put together with my hurt and pain that will always fight for my son and fight for other people. I like to say that at the Darrell Hudson Show, we highlight life heroes and zeros throughout the DMV and the nation as they turn tragedy into triumph, pain into purpose, and test into testimony to serve, help, bless, and make a difference in the world we are in now. So at this time, we're going to go to a break. When we come back from a break, we'll have our news segment with Rod Willis.
Smiling faces sometimes pretend to be your friend. Smiling faces show no traces of the evil that lurks within. Smiling faces, smiling faces, sometimes they don't tell the truth. Smiling faces, smiling faces, tell lies, and I got proof.
Foundation show, and I am Darrell Harrison the first.
I'm Rod Willis.
And like I said, once again, we want to discuss domestic violence today. You know, domestic violence, as I said earlier, have took on almost much killing in it than the homicide itself of people just killing one another. I mean, for a spouse, you know, it ain't just about a woman. It's a man, too, that can be going through domestic violence. But like I said, what it today is, you know, people have killed their spouse. You know, just last week, Rod, on a news, it was a secret agent from some type of police station, shot his wife, mm-hmm. and then put the gun on himself, and they was headed to divorce court that day.
That's right.
And, you know, he just took his life and her life. I mean, love is a very powerful thing. So what did you get in the statistics?
Well, statistics show the Center for Disease Control says that if you have a gun in your house, you're more likely to kill a person in your house than the person you think is coming through the door. And that's a sad commentary, but it's the truth. There are a number of accidental deaths that happen. Children stumble upon a, a gun that's not in a lockbox. Guy said, well, I ain't going to put it in no lockbox. There's dudes coming through the door. I don't have to run for a key. He wants to have access to it. But the danger is that children find ways to get into to guns. So you have a lot of situations where one sibling kills another sibling because he got access to a gun. You have a guy in a heat of passion. He thinks his wife is doing something. He's going to go and settle a score with a gun. So we have to be ever mindful that guns are dangerous, and in the wrong hands, in the wrong the hands of people who are unstable or mentally charged at that particular time, they're capable of taking a life. This past week, we want to give kudos to the young people down in Florida who organized a national walk out of school. I went up to Flowers High School, and Lord, they had a peaceful walkout. 2,100 students walked out.
That's awesome.
peacefully. And they had 17 minutes of silence, 1 minute for each student who was a person who was killed. And next week, there's a national organization. And the interesting thing about it, the National Rifle Association, who got a resounding defeat in Florida, is now saying that this is not a movement of children. They're saying it's been taken over by adults. It's been taken over by the left wing and Hillary Clinton. I don't think so. This time it is different because these children and the people who met death in Florida actually saw it. They are tired of people, as back home down south they used to say, shucking and jiving, and they want some results. They want to send people to Washington to make a result. It appears that the National Rifle Association has a death hole, a death grip on the votes that basically defy common sense. They don't want to get rid of the bump stops that can turn a semi-automatic into an automatic. That is insane. And somehow they think that this president may veto anything. They've watered down any legislation, but it is a start. And I commend these young folks who got out on the street. 17 minutes of silence all over the country. Now, some people suspended students who walked out. And to them, I say shame on them.
That was shame.
It's a lesson in civics, in civil disobedience. Constitution gives you a right to assembly, and they exercise it. And kudos to the young folk who stood up for something. I do want to mention that when two or three Negroes get killed in D.C. or four or five in Chicago, it doesn't seem to be a problem. Right. And we have to put an end to that. The FBI and Center for Disease Control says a mass killing is a killing where four or more people are killed. So if you kill three of brothers at night,
it ain't considered
it's
mass
not
killing.
A mass killing.
Yeah.
And three times three in St. Louis and D.C., Philly, Chicago, Detroit, Boston, New York, you know, that's 25 heads and some change. So we have to desensitize our own sensitivity to what killing is in our community and get our kids on back on track that thou shalt not kill. That means nobody. So kudos to the folk. And we just have to be vigilant on what goes on in our house and have gun safety as a primary tenet, because the likelihood of a person getting killed in the house who you are related to, somebody you love, is greater than the man you think coming through the door.
Yeah, but my thing is to discuss to the point that when it comes to domestic violence, it's a passion. You know, like the kill can be, I don't want to bring it up about the PG County police officer that was killed. The way he was killed, people find that as it was a passion. You know, when you love someone and the kill become personal from the passion of the love of the person. You know, if a man decided that he seen his wife or heard that his wife was cheating or caught her, he decided that he want to cut her up in little pieces. You know what I'm saying? That is a love, a passion of love that people turn into a murder. You know what I'm saying? They shoot the wife up, then shoot themselves up. Like one time they had a man that he went and killed his wife, mother and father, killed his mother and father, then killed her, killed himself and the kids.
Yeah.
All that over a passion of love. I mean, I don't know what it's like. I mean, I'm glad that I don't think that way, but someone think that way, that so much love hurt that they want to kill somebody like that, you know, as the guy that set the girl on fire, put her in the tub. Put her in the tub, drenched her with gasoline, and then put her on fire. Where do you get sick in your mind that if I can't have you, can't nobody have you, and you're going to, you know, decide to do this, you're going to jail. You know, so now, what was the girl named that got burnt in the T-Mobile?
Yvette Cave.
Yeah, you know, look at all the surgeries that she had. Yeah. You know what I mean? And she's a living testimony. You know what I'm saying? But she had to have so many surgeries, trying to get reconstructive surgery for her face and all that over over love. I mean, I'm going to talk real to y'all out there today. Ain't no need to... you know, we talking about sugarcoating it. We want to talk about all this over some pussy and a penis, a vagina and a penis. Get real with y'all. All this, I mean, you know, you got women out here that the men control you. Like, what, they got a gold penis or a gold tongue? All this because they love him. And then he love her so much that he want to beat on her. You know what I'm saying? Just like the baseball player just over the weekend. He got caught inside the stadium on the TV cameras inside the stadium smacking his girl.
Beating her up.
Yeah. Ain't no smacking her.
He was beating her
up. He down the
let loose.
He was I was like, girl, if you don't hit him back or something.
Where was this at?
He played for the Houston Astros.
Yeah, the baseball player.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, you should have seen how he was beating that girl.
Yeah, they just want
to knock the glasses off more than one time.
He need to be charged in out of baseball for the rest of his life. You know what I'm saying? That's just like when
that may happen.
The Baltimore Ravens, what was that running back named Rice? Taking out. I mean, you know what I'm saying? You can't just go around and just be beating on people just to be here. I mean, I don't even see it. I've been with my wife for over 39 years, and never once have I ever thought about putting my hands on her. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know how sometimes they hit you and you just got to shake them. Don't hit me, you know what I'm saying? You know, they hit you and you sometimes ought to reflex, you know, swing back.
See,
but you know, tell them, dude, I always tell them,
that ain't. When you can restrain yourself, that's love.
Yeah.
When you can't restrain yourself, that's not love.
Yeah.
I've been in an abusive relationship where I had my ex-husband to actually wrap his hands around my neck and say, I will kill you, bitch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's not love to me.
Oh, yeah.
That's why we're not together.
Amen. Amen.
Right. I mean, that's right, sister.
Speak,
that's right.
Baby.
So, David, what you see upon that, you know? What's your input?
Well, my input is love doesn't hurt in the manner that you have to put your hands on a person, whether it's a female to a male or a male to a female. Once that happens, you know, it's best for you to walk out or to get out of that relationship or friendship. Unfortunately, for some, they remain in the relationship.
Yep.
And it just escalates to another level, and whether it's death or bodily harm, unfortunately, the laws of stay away orders and the legal, it doesn't stop it, you know?
It doesn't.
If a person wants to bring harm upon you,
they come.
It's best for you to get away, walk away, because, you know, I have an 8-year-old daughter, and if anyone... Mm. puts their hands on my daughter.
Hello. Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm going to jail or they going to the grave.
To the morgue.
Something, yeah, right. I mean, understand. My daughter's in there, but I got 135, 33, and 24, and I'll tell any guy, don't put your hands on my kids at all. You know, don't put your hands on them. But see, also where it hurts a lot is the child that's in the family that sees the abuse. You know, I grew up with a guy that his father whooped his mother on a regular.
Right.
And he turned out the same way as his dad.
Right.
Beating a woman. You know what I'm saying?
And I came from being just totally desensitized or thinking that whooping on a woman was okay. I mean,
no, I mean, it's but you got to remember, kids even back then grew up by looking at behaviors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, they think it's right. Just like, you know, I'm just saying, I'm not, I mean, same sex marriage, you know, I'm not dealing with that. But the point is, whatever kids see, mm-hmm. it duplicates.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. It brings it back. You know what I'm saying? I noticed, like, one time my sister used to beat my nephew on the regular.
Uh-huh.
And he would beat his dolls saying the same thing that she said beating him.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh, my God. He, you know, so I'm just saying this domestic violence took on a new picture and a new law. So right now we're getting ready to go to a break. When we come back from a break, we're going to have a female rapper by the name of T-Bass is going to come up and entertain us. So we'll be back.
Yeah.
Right. Hey, Crystal.
One, two, three, four.
Darrell Harrison, Crime Victim Foundation Radio Show. I'm Darrell Harrison the First.
I'm Rod Willis.
And as we come back, like I told you, I'm bringing to y'all live from inside the studio, T-Spaz. How you doing today, T-Spaz?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for having me on the show.
No problem. Are you ready to put it down?
I'm ready.
You had to bring it.
Yep.
T-Spaz, everybody. Hey, Mike Bowman. How you doing?
Yeah. Yeah.
Fix your crown, queen. Get your head out the gutter. Stop chasing dudes, cause your rent due. You a mother, not another side chick. Trying to get a draft pick. Skirt above your thighs, trying to get 100 likes on your outfit. Put some respect on your name. Stop falling for the same games with the same names. Boyfriend at the boyfriend, you don't want that kind of fame. Get your education when times get rough. girlfriend. Time to speak the truth. Tired of seeing my sister's lost. Yeah, Barack was the president. Michelle was the boss. Time to stand in opposition. It's more to a woman than bare feet, pregnant, cooking chicken dinners in the kitchen. If you don't stand for something, you'll fall for anything. Don't give your body up for ransom, cause you want a wedding ring. Hey, pay your own bills and stack your own figures. Hold your head high, you were created a winner. You don't know, you are nothing less than a queen. You don't know, you can do it all, just believe. You don't know, get a job, get your own cheese. You don't know, you don't know, you don't know, you don't know, you don't know. You are nothing less than a queen. You don't know, you can do it all, just believe. You don't know, get a job, get your own cheese. You don't know, you don't know. You are nothing less than a queen. You can do it all, just believe. Get a job, get your own cheese.
You don't know, you don't know, you don't know.
Thank you, everyone.
I got him. Hey, hey, like, T-Spad, that was a good one.
That was good.
You are awesome. Queen, you don't
good
know.
Job. Good
hey,
job.
Hey, see,
love it. Say it now. I'm going to hear that
all
again.
All there that are queen.
You Motat.
You don't know.
Yes.
So right now, we're going to go to a break. When we come back, we are going to bring our guest speaker up. Peaches, survivor of domestic violence. So we be back with Peaches.
Carries a lot of weight for that beat, me, me, me.
Darrell Harris and Crime Victim Foundation Show. Like I said, my next guest, Peaches, you know, I want y'all to be able to have patience. Peaches has been a while since she ever told a story, and she decided to come here on Darrell Harris and Crime Victim Foundation to do a show, and I got my sister to back up, you know, so welcome to the stage.
Yay.
Peaches.
Thank you. Yay. You are so right. I mean, it's been, honestly, it's been 9 years since I've experienced domestic violence, and not even 9 years that I've experienced it, but it's 9 years that I've been out of it. So what it looks like today is just that God has given me a mouth to speak and to not be quiet and to let men and women alike know, like you were saying earlier, Mr. Harrison, is that domestic violence goes in men and women, it's in families, but more so though, I'm seeing it against women. And
okay, right.
That's what I'm here to speak out against today, like 9 years later. For me, I end up getting married in 2000. And I was one of those women, like you said, oh, just falling in love and having their head up in the clouds. And, oh, you know, this is what love looks like. But what I found out was is that my ex was a crackhead. And so after getting married to a perfect stranger, so I always urge women, get men as well, get to know your partner, get to know the person that you're dating. You know, take time to court that person and seek the advice of other believers. I mean, I urge people to go back to church again. I know it's been a struggle in the Black community as far as, you know, brothers and sisters going to church. But I urge you, that's what your answer is. Go to church. Go to church. If you can't trust your pastor, find a believer in church, a man or woman of God that you can pour into and that'll pour back into you. So that's what I didn't have. What happened to me was is that I had this crackhead husband that I just met, and 3 years later I reached out to a pastor, and this pastor told me that I sanctified my husband. And so because of that, I stayed. And then 2009, I realized my life was more important.
Right.
What I end up hearing God say is that I have plans to prosper you and not harm you. And I'm like, I'm in this situation that's not prospering me. I was like, I hadn't grown since I'd been married. And I took a few minutes to understand what does growth look like to God. And it wasn't to be abused. Once I closed that door and called the police to get this person out of my view and out of my life, it took my family to help me be strong, though. So I urge you men and women out here that are experiencing domestic violence to, you know, to clear the nonsense out of your heads. It's nonsense and it's fog that you're thinking when you're dealing with these men and women that are convincing you to be with them. Being hit is not okay. Being pushed around is not okay. And one thing that God reminded me is that I didn't want to disappoint my parents. So I didn't want to be another statistic, you know, another dead young woman out here, you know, not listening to the parents and just running the street. So, yeah, it was very, very hard. But I remember in 2007 losing my child, and that was another turning point in my life. It was just you know, being in this domestic situation and having my ex-husband. And ladies, I urge you to understand what a husband is.
Amen.
You know, go back to the word. If you don't have anybody that you guys trust, like go back to the Bible, go back to your dictionary and look up husband. I mean, because that's what's important. And me personally, I didn't have anybody to tell me what a husband looked like. you know, with a husband and man. I grew up in my family dealt with domestic violence. So what I knew and I understood is that I wanted to be the person that break the cycle, but I also didn't want to stop speaking. And so a lot of men in relationships tend to try to quiet a woman down or say, hey, stop talking. Right. You know, be quiet. And a woman's position is to be quiet. And that's mm-hmm. not true. A woman's position is to not be quiet, but to be meek and humble under her husband. And that's taken a lot of time to, and patience to understand.
Mm-hmm. A real
Yes, a real husband. Mm-hmm. And so 2009, when God actually strengthened me to get out of the situation and for him to actually be locked up, I actually had to go throughout our household to clean up. I mean, and what cleaning up looked like, I had to lift up mattresses and go through closets and get rid of his items. And so what I found was is a lot of knives. There's a lot of knives hidden under the bed. And dealing with a person that is under crack cocaine, they, you know, they steal your money, steal your debit cards, take TVs, pawn these things. But, you know, hearing a person talk about it, people just don't seem to think like, oh, that's real. It's very real.
Yes.
And so seeing these knives and everything up under my mattress, and I called my dad. And my dad was the person that actually strengthened me just to say, you know what, stay on the phone with me. Oh, and he stayed on the phone with me until the police came. And when the police came, I said, listen, I need you guys to stay because he's going to come back.
Right.
And so they didn't understand what that meant. I said, no, just like stay outside. I said, trust me, I've spent 9 years with this person, so I know.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he actually did come back, what God showed me is that the police officer got out of the car and was like, hey, you can't come back in this building. And so I knew it was over then.
Wow.
I was just relieved in 2009. It was December the 18th. So I'm really grateful to see today. I'm very, very thankful to be here with you guys. Mr. Harrison, thank you so much having me on your show. And I'm such a live wire. I'm like busting out with confetti all the time.
And that's fine. That's great. So let me ask you this.
Mm-hmm.
How long did you, because you mentioned a stranger.
Mm-hmm.
How long did you know your husband before you married him?
I knew him actually for about 8 months. It was about 8 months. And we took time. He courted me.
Okay, yeah.
But one thing about people that are in domestic violence, that are domestic to their partners, is that they don't show you everything all the time. They don't show you everything within the first 6 months or 3 months or even the first year. So it's important to, you know, really first to trust your parents and to listen to your parents and then to understand what courting means.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, which I did not. I was that young and dumb person. I was just like, oh my God, I'm in love. And things
yourself.
Are so wonderful.
You was not in that group
by yourself. So when did you first start noticing the signs of what you have got into? When did
after
you start?
After we got married.
That's when
like
the truth
that
came
evening.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that evening.
Wow.
That evening, what happened was is I was going through our drawer, and I found a little crack baggie. And I addressed it. You know, my job is, as a wife and as a woman, hey, it's time to address what you see. I was like, okay, what is this little thing?
Mm-hmm.
What is this little baggie? What is this white substance in there? And so he became very, you know, angry, very defensive, got the pushing and yelling. It came to just him drinking so much, though. He ended up drinking a lot. And that particular day, though, a light bulb went upside my head. And if you look really close, there's a split in between my eyebrow. And so that day, I was just like, okay, I don't know what to do. I was like, this is so much. I wasn't expecting that.
Mm. Hit you with a light bulb from a lamp?
From a lamp across the room. He ended up becoming so enraged to the point where I asked him, what is this?
Mm.
What is this?
And he had not done none of this through the 8 months y'all was just courting.
Nope. He was a perfect gentleman.
He waited till you became Mr. and Mrs.
This is why I tell his current fiance, chick, you better watch out. Mm-hmm. You better watch out. Mm-hmm. He's like, thank you for ruining our marriage. I'm like, no, thank you for giving me the opportunity in Jesus' name to be able to speak about what you have done. Mm-hmm. And for everybody, I want you guys to know his name. His name is Leonard Carmichael. And, you know, I want you guys to just understand the character of a person. Like it's been said, once you've hit a person once, it's going to happen again, ladies.
That what Queen
said. Again, yes. And again and again and again. Truth. And you cannot change that man. Mm-hmm. You can't change him through prayer. You can't change him through your
therapy.
Words.
No.
You can't.
A
you
woman
just can't.
Being is a woman being.
Correct.
Period. Ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about that.
Amen.
And we as women, you know, I think sometimes what we do is we try to justify the behavior. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of, you know, especially younger women, you know, oh, he loved me. Mm-hmm. If he didn't love me, he wouldn't care. If he cared, he wouldn't be going upside your head.
Correct.
Right. It's the message that we need to be teaching to our young girls. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Well, yeah. Somebody tried to, what they tried to say, I hit you because I love you.
Oh, yeah.
You know
the
what I'm
last
saying?
Time somebody that's tried it. That, they had a karate kick upside their thigh.
Yeah, I mean, ain't no love and no hate.
Yana,
so what do you have to say about that? Because you, I mean, I call you the expert on this because of what you, you know, let them know what happened with your daughter. Mm-hmm. You know, tell your story.
Okay, well, I am a survivor of domestic violence as well. I'm a third generation survivor. And my 18-year-old daughter was murdered by her boyfriend in 2007. And so that's when I started the organization. But just with all the education and training that I have had, you know, as a society of people, it has been accepted. Mm-hmm. Abuse. We have been accepting abuse since the beginning of time. Mm-hmm. And I tell even with, like, educators, we send our young children to school, and we have a little girl and a little boy there in kindergarten, and a little boy is pulling the girl's hair or hitting her. The first mm-hmm. thing that the adults will say in that situation, well, he just don't know how to express themselves. Mm-hmm. So in turn, little girls grow up to accept that if he likes me, mm-hmm. he's going to hit me because maybe right. he can't say how he feels.
Correct.
So we have to change the way how we talk and what we do. We have to be able to be role models. Like you say, mm-hmm. a lot of people don't know what a healthy relationship is.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. For me growing up, I never seen that. Mm-hmm. So all I knew in relationship was a lot of argue, fussing, and fighting, mm-hmm. gifts, providing, and mm-hmm. this is it. So mm-hmm. you grow up in this household, you see that, and next thing you know, you're out there, you're in relationship, and you're taking those same things that you learned in your household mm-hmm. into your own household, and mm-hmm. then you start having children. So mm-hmm. what we have to do as a community of people is that we have to say no longer will we accept abuse on any level, mm-hmm. whether it's from male or female, because there's a lot of aggressive females out here,
yes.
me, myself included. Mm-hmm. When I grew up, because I watched the abuse, I said, hey, that would never be me.
Sure.
So then I became mm-hmm. an abuser as well. So even in my marriage where it turned around, mm-hmm. I even had stabbed my husband and was locked up for that, even though I was in an abusive relationship. Mm-hmm. But at one point, the tables turned. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't that woman just in the house just accepting the abuse. We were fighting.
We were fighting in the house.
So it was going right. back and forth. Mm-hmm. But you know, when you think that that's normal, that's what mm-hmm. you do, even though right. you know it ain't right. Because mm-hmm. in your heart, you know it ain't right. You know right. I don't want to go through this. But it didn't take until the day I looked at myself in a mirror. Mm-hmm. I had a black eye. Mm-hmm. And I looked at myself in the mirror, and I didn't know who that woman was. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I didn't know her. Mm-hmm. I was like, who is this? Mm-hmm. So through that, and then with me being arrested for stabbing my husband, the judge sent me to anger management. So that's when I learned what I was bringing to the table. That's okay. when I realized how broken I was, that mm-hmm. I had rejection issues and yes. abandonment issues, mm-hmm. that every time he tried to walk away, I didn't let him.
Okay.
Okay.
Really?
I didn't
being
let him
real,
walk
sister.
Away.
That's being real.
Because if he walk away to me, you're rejecting me, and no, right. you got to deal with this. Mm-hmm. And so the only thing I know how to do is be physical.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to pull you back. I pulled them back into it. Mm-hmm. And so then you get somebody that comes from that same background that they just as broken as you. And I call it a perfect storm.
It is. All right.
A perfect
All right.
storm for domestic violence.
All right.
And so we have to be able to say, okay, that I have some things about me that I need to know. Why do I do the things that I do? Mm-hmm. And even when I go out and speak to teens, I speak to teen boys because even they have become susceptible to accept the abuse from young girls. They are being mm-hmm. pinched. They are mm-hmm. being harassed. Mm-hmm. They are being smacked. And because they have been told to never put your That's hands right. on a female, mm-hmm. they like, well, it. Okay, well, what do I do?
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like an abuse of an animal. If you keep kicking a dog, eventually mm-hmm. it's going to get up and bite you.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So
That's
right. we have to learn how to keep our hands to ourselves, mm-hmm. women and men. Mm-hmm. We have to understand what love is. Mm-hmm. And like she said, you have to go back to that good book mm-hmm. where God gives us an example of what love is.
Mm-hmm.
And when I speak, I tell people to go to 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, where God gives a breakdown of what love is.
Mm-hmm.
And what you do, you take your significant other. Mm-hmm. And everywhere where it says love, you say James.
Mm-hmm.
And you say James is patient. Mm-hmm. James is kind. Mm-hmm. Teresa is patient. And if you can't say that, you have to reevaluate your relationship
right. mm-hmm.
because you don't have love. Mm-hmm. A lot of times we have misinterpreted love, but love ain't never hurt nobody.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Love ain't never abused nobody. So mm-hmm. we got to stop calling it love because it's not love.
That's right.
Like Tina Turner said, what's love got to do with it?
Right.
Yeah.
Because that's not love.
Secondhand love.
So let me ask you this, Mia. So my thing is, I'm trying to see, so in your relationship, and it happens sometimes, mm-hmm. some women would take the abuse and become broken.
Mm-hmm.
And, but as you saying, you took the abuse and then you came violent back to stop it.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And that's well, a good thing sometimes, but still being in the relationship, I mean, because I'd rather for the woman to, if the guy beating on you, I'd rather for him to take something and bust him in the head with it,
mm-hmm.
to teach him to stop hey, putting his hands
but,
on you.
But that doesn't, see, but that doesn't
necessarily
yeah.
stop
it. Yeah, it don't stop it, but
yeah.
for some of
slow
for a
down,
minute.
Though, for yeah. you get away. I mean,
stop it for a minute.
Slow down.
You know, that's all you need. You know, remember that record, A Thin Line Between Love and Hate?
Yeah. Sure.
The guy said in the record, I didn't think my woman would do this to me.
Right.
She put him in the hospital.
Right.
Almost dead.
And it's not intentional. I don't believe that, like the day my daughter died, I did not believe that her boyfriend got up that day and said, you know what, today I'm going to kill you.
Right.
I believe that it was an altercation. An altercation that got out of hand with two people not knowing how to deal with it.
Wow.
And it just got out of hand.
Mm-hmm.
Because I read a book a few years ago, and it was a psychologist, and he said that we are all just one person away from being a murderer.
Absolutely.
It depends wow, on wow. the situation
it's true.
That we're
that's
in.
That's real. Talk.
It's
that
very
can happen
true.
To any of us.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how we have to learn how to communicate, how to effectively communicate with each other, mm-hmm. How do we give our children conflict resolution skills. Mm-hmm. A lot of people think that confrontation always got to be bad.
Correct.
No. Confrontation is that you're just trying to get an understanding with someone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I understand.
But because mm-hmm. we are told to shut things down and not deal with things, it is never dealt with. And so you may have an argument that happened on Monday,
mm-hmm.
and because you haven't dealt with it, mm-hmm. and then Thursday here come another situation, mm-hmm. now it's an escalator.
Mm-hmm. Right. You're right.
Now it's mm-hmm. pain on top of pain, and pain is never being dealt with. And so that's why we get the saying that hurt people hurt people.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I got a question, ma'am. Your daughter was the third generation of women or people to be abused. Where do you
fourth.
Think? Fourth.
Fourth generation.
I stand corrected.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you think she learned it and got it from?
Did from she, living in my household. She grew
did
up,
she get it from you?
She grew up in my household. I was a victim of domestic violence ever since I was 16 years old, from 16 to 34.
Mm-hmm.
Every relationship had some form of abuse in it.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Every relationship, whether it was verbal, physical, emotional, anything.
Mm-hmm.
I had that in my relationship, and I've learned to just deal with that. And so you have children growing up watching that.
Mm-hmm.
So like they say, they mimic your behavior,
mm-hmm.
especially even with little boys. It's mm-hmm. twice. They are twice.
they are twice as likely to grow up and repeat the behaviors they've seen in their household. Saying.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
And daughters, and how I see with my daughter, with her seeing me in an abusive marriage, because that's the only relationship that she's seen that type of behavior in, and that was in my marriage. It wasn't with her dad. This is another gentleman. And basically, it was a very time in her life where she was very impressionable. So I showed her how to stay because of the house. He bought me a house. He bought me gifts. And he did these different things. So I stayed for the gifts. I stayed for the gifts. Because in my family, that's what they did. That's what the women did. Mm-hmm. You know, he buys you a house. Mm-hmm. You get a new car every
two years.
You get a new car every 2 years. You know, you get all these things. Mm-hmm. And then I came from a very religious family. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So then the church had another part in that where, mm-hmm. okay, the church can't know, pastor can't know you going through all these mm-hmm. things in your house. You we go to strong. Church every Sunday. We dressed up. My family hold very high positions in the church. Mm-hmm. But my grandfather was not a Christian, was not a man of God. He was an alcoholic. That the first man, when my dad walked out, the second man that's supposed to show me what a man is, he failed too because he was an alcoholic and he was an abuser. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So when you're seeing that, I learned early how not to have respect for men.
Okay.
I learned early how to emasculate a man.
How did you emasculate a man?
Talking down to him, telling him that he's mm-hmm. nothing. Mm-hmm. That ain't nothing you can do for me but buy me things. Your worth was nothing. Right. Mm. Your worth was nothing. So I had that vicious tongue, what they say of some women, of how you can cut a man down.
No question.
And I didn't know that until I had therapy. When I had therapy is when it opened up all of that from my childhood, of how I grew up and how I viewed things. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's so important to find out who you are. Mm-hmm. Yes. Now, today, I know who I am. I know that all that I've been through, it doesn't make me who I am, but it helped me become the person that I am today.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am. Okay.
So
thank you.
You're welcome. So it's very important to what we show our children in the household.
One last question. What message do you have to these young boys out here? Because some boys are victims of domestic violence, but they see their fathers get beat up. Mm-hmm. They see their fathers get abused. Their fathers have told them, don't ever put your hands on a woman. But the women are steadily
putting their hands on them.
Oh, they taking them out, man.
Yeah,
throwing haymakers.
Mm-hmm.
They reaching back into Mississippi and throwing mm-hmm. punches.
Swing and back. Also, they're killing them. There is men that has been murdered from domestic violence. There is women that's sitting in jail right now for killing their significant other.
So what message do you have to the young boys that are seeing this? They've been told you don't hit a woman, but they see their fathers get beat up, and then they go to school, and the person in authority is a woman teacher. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then there are women, girls on the playground to be taking dudes out. So I've seen, I don't know what you call it, the wimpetization mm-hmm. of boys who've been taught the scripture, you don't hit women, but they got some women with some foul tongues, mm-hmm. and they be throwing haymakers, and they talk abusive, and they talk a lot of smack, and some of them, I've even heard them say, chump them, yeah, hit me, and I'll call the police, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. and I'll lock your monkey something up. Mm-hmm. So a lot of guys have been chumped and are afraid of their own shadow. And so what message do you have to the young boys out here, 14, 15, 16 years old, that are seeing this going on for the second, third generation?
Well, they have to know their worth as well. Like I always say, we can't keep telling women know their worth now. We've been telling women for a long time
to
know your worth.
Know your worth.
Women know their worth. But now it's time for the men to know their worth, to know that you don't have to be subjected to this type of behavior mm-hmm. as well, that there is help for you too. Mm-hmm. Is that it's okay that if, because with men, domestic violence, that stigma is, I'm not a punk.
Right.
It don't have anything to do with being a punk. Mm-hmm. You know, it's about, okay, if this person is talking down to me, belittling me, I don't have to be subjected to this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I can walk away from this relationship, too. We have to give them back their power mm-hmm. to know that you don't have to live in this situation.
Right.
And we have to start teaching them as young teens because they're dealing with it. They're dealing with domestic violence as young as 13 years old.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, you got mothers that can abuse their son mm-hmm. with certain down language. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. you lazy, get up. You ain't no woman going to never want you. You know what I'm saying? You find mothers in the home that abuse the boys in that way, too. And then they end up growing up getting a woman that the same way was their mother.
They find Absolutely. A woman you know just what, like
You know what
mama.
We have found mm-hmm. out with a lot of young boys because of that? A lot of young boys have been abused by their mothers and things in the household. And so when they grow up hating women. Mm-hmm. Because the woman, the first woman that was supposed to love them and nurture them and mm-hmm. take care of them, she failed. So they look at other women. Okay, well, then if my own mother didn't love me and mm-hmm. failed doing this, who are you and what you going to do? Mm-hmm. So it becomes that I'm going to get you before you get me.
That's right. Right.
So I'm Absolutely. Not invested. Even though I'm in this relationship, I'm not invested in this relationship. Mm-hmm. Because I'm just buying time.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know what I'm saying? I'm just buying time until the next one comes. I'm just moving through the system.
Moving on. That's yeah. right.
I mean, domestic violence is it's a really scary thing because it has become more public. Mm-hmm. We can walk out here today and find a couple outside rumbling and fighting. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Or you could see a man beat. I mean, it's all out. You know, usually it's behind closed doors.
That's right. That's
you know
right.
what I'm saying?
Right.
The wife right. talking about where the door hit me. Mm-hmm. You know, she walk around with sunglasses on, mm-hmm. trying to cover up the abuse that her husband doing to her. But now today, they don't care who see it. I mean, it's just a normal. Mm-hmm. It becomes a normal now.
It's because, to me, we have all turned our back to it. You know, when we see that couple fighting, we be like, that ain't my business.
Yeah, right. True.
We live inside apartment buildings and we hear a woman screaming. We like, that ain't my business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you keep on denying something, eventually it's going to show right up to your door. Mm-hmm. And so now it's
yeah,
in our face now.
Go.
And
That's
so now we
about.
Like, okay, what do you do? But you got to get to the point where you say, you know, if you see something, you have to say something.
Mm-hmm.
If you hear a woman screaming in her apartment, not that you get on social media and say, oh, they fighting again,
right.
call the police.
Yeah, right. That's right. That's right. Yeah.
I think another thing that I want to add in, too, by me having a son and three grandsons,
mm-hmm.
What I try to teach them, and I've already taught my son, is first of all, you're not to be abused by anybody
right.
for any stretch of the imagination.
Right.
But I also try to let them know, okay, if you have a misunderstanding or a confrontation or something with a female, that's what us females in the family are for.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? You can always come to us and talk to us. And sometimes it doesn't always have to, you know, spiral into violence or whatever. Sometimes mm-hmm. I know I've been able to just, that's my baby calling me right now, Ashley. But sometimes, you know, you can give them the advice to kind of like curtail.
Mm-hmm.
You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they can do it. I noticed a lot with my son when he was younger. He had a lot of anger in him, I think, because of my divorce. But I know that, you know, me being there as his mom and reinforcing in him, you know, first of all, not to put his hands on women,
mm-hmm.
number one, and then also letting him know, I'm still here for you to come to talk to. We can work this out together
mm-hmm.
before you raise your hand to strike a woman.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
So, you know, when we have multiple choices, I think that gives more than one direction. Because if you're just saying, okay, don't hit a girl, don't hit a girl, don't get hit a girl, that's the only, you know, idea that they're gonna have.
Right.
But if you say, now you're not supposed to hit a girl because of this, but mm-hmm. if you do have a situation, you bring it to me. My son has, you know, sisters. You know, Unique was always very, you know, vigilant about her brother. Okay, so my son had that outlet because he knew he had another alternative. When you have more options and more alternatives, you make better choices. So that's what we're instilling in my grandsons now. You know what I mean? You don't have to, just because somebody comes to you with, I was always taught that, you know, you get bees with honey, not with vinegar. So if you give them multiple avenues and ideas to think of when they're in these situations, then the outcome can be better. because you have more than one avenue for an outcome. If you only have one avenue for one outcome, that's all you're going to get. Like, okay, whatever, a woman puts her hands on you, you put her hand, that's all you're going to get. But if you let him know, okay, well, like with my son, for example, you know, when he has arguments or whatever, you know, with his female friends or whatever, sometimes I'll say, okay, well, let me talk to her.
Really?
And I can, mm-hmm. you know, I can level it out right there. Mm-hmm. First of all, the same way I tell my son not to put his hands on you, don't you put your hands on my son. So when it's more than one avenue, then I find that that worked a whole lot better.
Do you find that it's easier for your son, if he's having a confrontation with a woman or your grandson, for him to come to you as a referee or the person to intervene because... Yeah. Average man ain't gonna tell another man, hey man, this woman's beating
yeah,
me up.
Exactly.
And what can I, exactly. He ain't gonna do it.
I had that
straight
experience
up, he's not gonna
before.
Do it.
I had that experience before when my son called me. He was like, Mom, this girl is crazy. I'm like, just leave for right now. We'll deal with it later. You know
so
what I'm saying?
Ain't letting him
First
go.
Of all, just get out of the situation, which I was trying to defuse the situation over the phone. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But then, you know, once we had
She's
a chance to
crazy.
Sit down and talk about mm-hmm. it and... You know, I just came to her, you know, woman to woman now. You know, I'm his mother, but don't forget he got sisters now.
Right.
Okay, so he's not going to be your punching bag. If you're going to put your hands on my son, leave him alone. Mm-hmm. And I tell my son the same thing about his women.
Mm-hmm. What made him think they could do that, though?
A lot of times I found, I mean, I've done my own studies on... men that are in that choose to be violent, because earlier you guys were saying, you know, when a person sees it in their household, they tend to be that way. Well, my uncle saw it. My uncle's not that way. My uncle's a great husband to his wife, so it has skipped him. But to answer your question, I just find that a lot of men that are in the situation, they don't know how, like we've been saying all afternoon, they don't know how to express their anger. Mm-hmm. They don't know, they don't understand that the place that they're in is a comfortable place. And like you were saying, you have to be able to find like a safe place to be mm-hmm. able to release your feelings, to get a second evaluation about yourself and about the situation that you're
and
in.
And calm down, too.
And calm down.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to get ready to break. Mm-hmm. But I want to thank you, too, mm-hmm. for both coming out to share your story. I also want y'all to see their shirts they got on.
Oh, beautiful.
Their shirts reading.
Yes.
And those are Darrell Harrison Crime Victim Foundation t-shirts that I make. Yes. And it says, she is not your punching bag.
That's right.
I love it.
You know, and then you have the other shirts out here. So I do deal with domestic violence. So anybody out there want to get a domestic violence t-shirt, you can. So right now, we're going to go to a break. After we come back from break, we're going to hear from T-Zazz, Spaz, and then, you know, we're going to go the rest of the way.
She coming so, back again.
A second thought. It's a thin line.
you sit back and enjoy it. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Between love and hate, she won't fool you one day. The sweetest woman in the world. She keep being quiet. She might be holding something inside that'll really, really hurt you one day. Here I am laying in the hospital, bandaged from feet to head, in a state of shock, just that much from being dead. Do something like this to me. Didn't think my girl had the nerve. Here I am. I guess action speaks louder than words.
It's a thin line between love and hate.
Don't think you can keep treating your woman bad.
To the Darrell Harrison Crime Victim Foundation Radio Show. I am Darrell Harrison first.
And I'm Rod Willis.
And like I said, when we come back, we got T-Spaz.
Yeah.
T-Spaz, if you got something just like that Queen song.
Well, this one is a lot different. This is something that I wrote when I was going through a real tough time. I was really depressed, and usually my music isn't sad, but I wanted to express myself. And, you know, just let other people know who went through what I went through or where I was at that point, that they're not alone, and just sharing what I went through when I was at this dark period of my life. So I'm going to do this a cappella.
Okay.
So the title of this is Hard to Live, because at this point in my life, when I was at that point, it was hard for me to live. Mm-hmm. Sitting in the dark room, thoughts all crazy. Depression on my mind, suicide trying to take me. Crying out to God, why would you even create me? My life's so meaningless. I mean, maybe I had some potential, but where did it go? I'm in storm after storm, and I'm looking for a way out. Devil said me and him, we should hang out. Wanna cry for help, but then again, I'm cried out. I put a smile on my face to hide all my pain. Sometimes the strongest person is the one with all the pain. What good is having riches when your heart's filled with shame? Dark spirits holding me down in my bed. I can't scream. I wanna die, but something keeps wanting me to live, and I don't know why. It's either best in the kid. All my mistakes plays over and over in my head, trying to see a brighter day, but on the inside I'm dead. Standing in the shower, water running down my face, thinking of ways I can't escape this awful place. In faith, I lost that a long time ago. When I saw my mama in that casket, that's when I let it go. Never let my feelings show. My ex taught me that. Matter of fact, I would never ever fall in love again. My heart turned cold, and I don't even really care. And I didn't want to lose my faith, I swear. But life ain't fair. They say they care, but they never dare. Now I'm crying out for help, but I can't find it anywhere. I see the Bible on the dresser. Maybe it's a sign, or maybe God is tired of hearing this girl lying. I'm trying to steady die, keep crying, but nothing's changing. God, if you're real, come into me and change me. I'm on a dark path, and there's no light, trying to hold on with all of my might. It gets hard to live. Thank you.
Hear your music. Do you have any information that you can give my viewers so they can go to your website or whatever you have set up to go to?
Sure. You can find me on the social media outlets under T-Spaz. It's T with a dash, Spaz, S-P-A-Z-Z. Also, I'm on IG at The Realty Spaz. For bookings, therealtyspaz@gmail.com.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, great, great. Awesome.
Thank you.
Hey, Nate. Okay, at this time, I'm fast now. I need your help. Now, at this time, I want to present my guest. Can you get this to and Valencia has on one of my shirts. Let them see your shirt, Valencia. Have one of my shirts on about stop violence, stop the killing.
Okay. All right.
So at this time, I want to present this to my artist, T Spaz.
Oh, praise God.
And, you know, as we always got Daryl logo on the back, Lord Daryl LD. Can you give it that too?
Thank you.
And then at this time, since Peaches already got one of them shirts, I want to give Peaches this one here.
Peaches.
Why must love be harmful to me and kill me? Stop Domestic Violence, Daryl Hurts, a crime victim foundation. Right. If you're interested in getting these shirts from me, you got to inbox me, go to my website, DarylAHurston.com. DarylAHurston.com if you want to check out my t-shirts, then inbox me. Let me know if you want to. So like I said, I want to definitely thank my guests, you know, for them to be able to come and share their story. You know, it's not easy to come out, even with me. I don't really like no more to discuss, you know, the killing with Daryl. You know, I've been called for interviews, but I just don't feel like going through it again, you know, talking to people. I just want to go from where I'm at today. So I appreciate you ladies coming out and giving us this information, you know, not being afraid to let someone know your story, not feeling that you're embarrassed about what you went through, because somewhere today, there's many ladies, young girls, are going through this at a young age and don't understand and don't know why. So your stories today here really help them. And like I said, I really appreciate y'all coming out. I appreciate my guest David Willer coming out on the show today. I want to thank Valencia Hurst.
I wanted to give a shout out again today. At this point to Tina Brown's family. Tina Brown's Kelvin Darnell Brown was murdered back in 2015, and unfortunately this morning I had to attend Tina's funeral. Tina passed away on March the 6th, apparently in her sleep, and I just want to give, you know, all the love and support to her family as I possibly can, and I also want to let them know that, you know, Calvin's case is not forgotten. We will not forget about Calvin. We will continue to press forward for resolution in Calvin's case. It's not going to stop with Tina. I mean, for me and Tina to have never met each other face to face, she impacted me enough that I rode from Richmond, Virginia today to come to her funeral. Mm-hmm. She was one of the most sweet, loving, positive people that I have ever run into. And I just want to, you know, give a shout out to her family and let her family know, all of us here, you know, we still love and support you all, and we are not going to stop seeking justice for Calvin. It does not stop with Tina. And anything and any help that you all need from me personally, please just don't hesitate to reach out and, you know, talk to me. I got a chance to meet Tina's mom this morning. Me and my brother David Wheeler, we made it over to that church this morning. I was running behind and everything. You know, when you're trying to do the right thing, Satan throws all kinds of obstacles in your way to try to slow you down and stop you and make you take another route and everything else. But thank God we managed to get there. Unfortunately, I didn't get to give, you know, my sister the last kiss that I wanted to because I was running behind. But, you know, I know she knows because the conversations that we had, you know, I'll never forget them. And I'm just so thankful that the last words that her and I said to each other was, I love you. I love you, sis.
Amen.
You know, and you know how Tina is.
Yeah, I know.
You know,
we spend time
talking
on the phone.
Don't worry, we represented today.
Most definitely. So, you know, like she said with Tina Brown, she was an awesome sister. She lost her son. She was part of the family, the foundation of losing a child. And in the process of us trying to research her case and give the police information, Tina Brown died in her sleep. Mm-hmm. And that's what the pain and grief does to us. So, like I said, we, you know, I appreciate you bringing up Tina Brown and sending out. So right now we're going to go to a break. Y'all know when we come back from the break, wake up everybody. Thank you. Welcome back to the Darrell Harrison Crime Victim Foundation show. I am Darrell Harrison the First.
Rod Willis.
And everybody know what this time of the moment is. It's the ending of a show. We want to thank our guests and everybody being here. But as we say to you out there, wake up, everybody. Wake up to what's going on in this world today so we can make a difference. So y'all know the song by now. Join in with me. Dance with me.
Shout.
Thank you.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty. Oh, teach a new way. Maybe then they'll listen to what you have to say. They're the ones who's coming up, and the world is in their hands. When you teach the children, teach them the very best you can. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Na, 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 na. And me.
All right.
Wake up, all the doctors, make the old people well. They're the ones who suffer and who catch all the hell. They don't have so very long before their judgment day. So won't you make them happy before they pass away? It's time to build a new land. I know we could do it if we all lend a hand. The only thing we have to do is put it in our minds. Surely things will work out. They do it every time. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. Change the world, just you and me. Change the world, just you and me. Change the world, change the world. Can't do it alone, can't do it alone. I need some help, y'all. Can't do it alone.
So bless all you out there until next Friday.
Yeah. Huh. All right.
Wake up, everybody.
There you go.
Amen.
Amen, brother.